Svarnam Sarvatma Snapanam Param Vijayate Shri Krishna Sankirtanam. Glory to the Shri Krishna Sankirtan, which cleanses the heart of all the dust accumulated for years and extinguishes the fire of conditional life of repeated birth and death. The Sankirtan movement is a prime benediction for humanity at large because it spreads the rays of the benediction moon. It is the life of all transcendental knowledge. It increases the ocean of transcendental bliss, and it enables us to fully taste the nectar for which we're always anxious. Nam nam akahi bahuda nija sarva shaktis tatrapitani amitas manane nakalaha etatrashita bakripa bhagavan mamapi durgai gomindrisham iha janinanuragaha. Oh my Lord, your holy name alone can render all benediction to living beings, and thus you have hundreds and millions of names like Krishna and Govinda. In these transcendental names you have invested all your transcendental energies. There are not even hard and fast rules for chanting these things. Oh my Lord, out of kindness you enable us to easily approach you by your holy names, but I am so unfortunate that I have no attraction for them. Chena rapi suni chena to rapi sahishnuna amani namanalena kirtaniya sarahari. One should chant the holy name of the Lord in a humble state of mind, thinking oneself lower than the straw in the street. One should be more tolerant than a tree, devoid of all sense of false prestige, and should be ready to offer all respect to others. In such a state of mind, one can chant the holy name of the Lord constantly. Nadananda Jananda Sundarim Kavatamba Jagadisha Kamaye Amama Janmani Janmani Shware Bhagavan Bhakti Rohate Kitvayim. O my Lord, I have no desire to accumulate wealth.
Aditamam vishame bhavamburam Vrihaya tala para pankajas Vidahuli sadriksham vichintaya.
O son of Maharajana Krishna, I am your temple sister, yet somehow or other, fallen into the ocean of earth and death. Please bring me up from this ocean of death and place me upon the atoms which are those
Nayanam Gavashudaraya Varanam Gagaraviya Gira Pura Kenichetam Babukara Kalamani Vishuti.
O my Lord, when will my eyes be decorated with tears of love flowing constantly when I chant your holy names? When will my voice wake up? When will the hairs of my body stand on end at the recitation of your names?
Yugayitam Mishena Chakshusha Ravishayitam Shunyayitam Jagat Sarvam Govinda Vyayaname.
O Govinda, feeling your separation, I'm considering born to be like 12 years or more. Tears are flowing from my eyes like torrents of rain, and I'm feeling all vacant in the world of your absence.
Ashishava Paravitam Dinashtumam Adarshanam Mahatam Karotuva Yatatatava Viratulam Pato Mahana Vasusayana Param.
I know no one but Krishna as my Lord, and if he shall remain so, even if he handles me roughly by his embrace, or when he makes me brokenhearted, I cannot leave the prison before me. He is completely free to do anything and everything, for he is always my worshipful Lord, unconditionally.
Param Vijayate Shri Krishna Sankirtanam Ki
Jai.
Auspicious occasion of Govardhan Puja. That's the day where we'll hear what happened on this day. Of course, you all already know. Yes? Who doesn't know what happened on Govardhan Puja Day? Okay, you all very kind. So we'll pretend like nobody knows. Especially you, Kathy. So there are many songs we could sing, and I looked into a few of them, but again, I thought Jagrata Madhav is also very good, mentions Govardhan pastime, and also is recommended. There are a few sites on Govardhan Parikram where Jagrata Madhav is a good song to also chant and sing. So we'll just say that, and then our time is a little bit limited this morning, so we'll crack on. Jaya Radha Madhava
Oh, baby.
Jai All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. Glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the lotus feet of Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasad. Srimad Radha Swami Tamandi. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasad. Saraswati Hare Krishna. So welcome everyone, thank you for being present for this very auspicious day and ecstatic fun festival. Probably one of the funnest, most exciting festivals of the year. At least it kind of used to be. This year is a little different. But hopefully not so different. We're not going to read a specific verse, we're just going to discuss the pastime and some different bits and pieces. And we probably need to finish close to 9, so that there can be time to set up for the abhishek and everything. So I'll do my best. Before I begin, I would like to seek blessings from all the assembled Vaishnavas that you see fit to bestow your mercy upon me so that I can speak something relevant and bona fide on this exalted topic matter of the lifting of Govardhan Hill and Govardhan Puja pastime. Only by the mercy of Vaishnavas is anything possible, so I'm seeking your blessings. And you can chant the Mangala Charanam prayers. Om Ganatini Nandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurumilitangena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Bandeham Shri Gurum Shiyuta Parakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sarvaitam Savadutam Harijana Saritam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakam Vitamscha Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Yagapate Gopisha Gopika Kanta Madhva Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurange Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Adi Priye Vancha Kalpa Charuyascha Kripa Sindhu Vyayevacha Patithanam Pavanevyo Vaishnavelyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadhi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Srila Prabhupada ki jai Govardhan Puja ki jai. So today is the auspicious occasion of the lifting of Govardhan Hill and the entire Govardhan Leela. So I presume some people are not familiar with it. So we'll discuss basics of the pastime. So in Krishna book, this pastime starts, or Krishna book, it's chapter 24. and it spans up until chapter 27. So for Krishna book, that's quite a lot of chapters for a specific pastime. And in the middle of the pastime, there is the chapter called Wonderful Krishna, where Krishna gets glorified quite a lot. So this is a very intimate and special pastime. And you could give hours and hours and hours of talks and discussions on this pastime. There's so many intricacies. It's also interesting to point out where this pastime comes in Krishna's Leela. Anyone knows what it follows on from? What is the previous Leela that leads to this pastime? Say it again. Something about a sacrifice. Okay. Sounds good. You're kind of on the right track, yeah?
He does upset Indra,
that's for daggone sure. Yeah, he upsets Indra. But that's, yeah, I mean, I'm talking about which in the Krishna's Leela, like which chapter 23 about, anyone remembers? Because it's relevant. Anyway, chapter 23 is about the deliverance of the wives of the brahmanas. Yes, so you're right. It's about something about a sacrifice. And why is that relevant and significant? Because actually, the pastime where delivering the wives of the brahmanas, we know the brahmanas were very much attached to their
rituals,
their puja, the yajna. So when Krishna and Balaram sent some of the cowherd boys to them to get some boga or some prasad or whatever they could offer to them, then what was their response?
No.
We're too busy. We're too busy with our yajna, with our puja, swaha, to do what? To serve
Krishna.
So this is the interesting thing. So after that, Krishna and Balaram said, okay, so cowherd boys, go back again to the house, and this time don't ask the brahmanas, but ask the
wives
of the brahmanas, and let them know that we're here in the forest and we're very
hungry.
And let's see what they do. And when the cowherd boys go back and tell the wives of the brahmanas that Krishna and Balaram are in the forest and they're hungry, what do the wives of the brahmanas do? They immediately gather up as much prasad as they can and they go to the forest. They just left the whole thing. Now, of course, generally when brahmanas are performing their yajnas, their wives are meant to be present, they're meant to be assisting, but they just were like, out the door, immediately went. And they served Krishna and Balaram. And then Krishna and Balaram became so ecstatic and they blessed them and basically delivered them. And the whole point was that the brahmanas then became a little bit bewildered. And they realized, oh, we've made a grave mistake. But even after realizing they made a big mistake, they still couldn't go and serve Krishna Balaram because they were afraid of Kamsa. They were afraid if they got caught out that Kamsa would kill them. So Prabhupada explains how this ritualistic mentality is a great hindrance in our progress in devotional service. And so when Krishna Balaram return to where Nanda and all the cowherd men are, they realize that they're actually getting together some big puja, some yajna event, and they're inviting all the brahmanas. And so Krishna and Balaram are like, okay, now what's going on here? And so they realize that actually they're going to perform a big yajna for who?
Indra.
Yes, for Lord Indra. And and Krishna is thinking, well, why are you going to perform some big yajna for Indra? So he goes to Nanda and the other senior men and the brahmanas, and he begins to petition them that actually this is silly for you to offer worship to Indra. You know, he doesn't supply everything. You know, ultimately, who's supplying everything? Govardhan Hill's supplying everything. So we get all of our needs from Govardhan Hill because the cows go there and they eat the grass and then they supply the milk. And then there's so many beautiful forests with so many fruit trees and so many things that grow there and all the beautiful waters, and everything we need is coming from Govardhan Hill. So therefore, don't worship Indra. No need for all of that. It's just wasting time. You should actually worship Govardhan Hill. And somehow or other, his arguments, the arguments of how old was Krishna at this point? Close. Well, that means you got two guesses that maybe even closer. 9. And you went the wrong direction. There you go. Well done. Yeah, so it's described that Krishna was 7 years old. So he convinced everyone that they should all cook many, many, many preps, nice preparations. And in Krishna book, I'm not reading it just because we don't want anyone to get too hungry, start meditating on all these different preps. But there are so many different preparations, many especially made from milk, milk products, to prepare and put together and offer on the hill. So actually, in Govardhan, devotees also do this. This is from Radhanath Maharaj's yatra some years ago, where they all, if you see the whole scene, this is on the hillside, but on the other side where they set up their camp, then all the ladies will make little stoves like they do. Anyone's been to Vrindavan, they make stoves out of mud. You dig a hole and then you use the mud to form like a little kind of mud stove, and then you put some cow dung patties inside the hole, light it on fire, you're cooking. And actually it's described Vedically, cooking with cow dung is first class. Cooking with cow dung is first class. Cooking with wood is second class. Cooking with gas is third class. And cooking with electric is basically no class. But anyway, the idea is you cook with cow dung. And it's quite amazing, the whole thing with cow dung is once it lights and the cow dung patties, and if you've ever been, anyone's been to India and sees, well, not in India, but even in the cities, if you see it, but you see walls with these round things on them, you might want, and they got a handprint, usually there's some handprint in them. Well, that's cow dung, that's cow patties. So the ladies will gather up, and you'll see them sometimes with the big baskets on their head, and it's filled up with cow dung. And they take it back to the house, and they pat them out and put them on the walls, and that's it. You're good to cook and keep warm. Everything comes. But when you light those dried cow patties, you start to burn them. They just burn so evenly and slowly. So they do a slow burn at like a high temperature, but also very evenly. So it's very easy to cook on. Not like if you use wood, often you put wood and you light it, it goes, and then you have to wait for the coals, and then the coals also go out very quickly. And cow dung is obviously, because it's 100% pure, then when you cook with it, even the smoke is pure, it's purifying. And sometimes, I know one thing I always remember is, especially when traveling from Vrindavan back to Govardhan side in the evening, and you often have to travel before it gets dark, because if you're on the Govardhan side, going through Radha-Kund, there are lots of dacoits on the road, and they will try to stop your rickshaw, and they can even try to rob you. That happened to us one time, and we were like, you know, somebody was laying in the road, and somebody, we were driving, and it was like, oh no, it's dark now. And then we saw the light, somebody was laying in the road, and some guy was saying, stop, stop, he got hit, we need help, we need help. And we were going, don't stop, don't stop. And the driver stopped, and then this guy grabbed hold of the rickshaw, and I just shouted, move, last car! And he took off, and the guy got out of the road, and we drove off. So it can be very dangerous. But apart from the danger, there's this amazing aroma that fills the atmosphere, especially in the evening time. Sometimes you get it in Mandara in the countryside where people are burning their in-house fires. Usually it's coal fire, it's not the same kind of smell, but it's the smell of cow dung burning, and it just emanates, and you can almost see the smoke laying, you know, along the sides in the rice paddies and in the paddies along the way, and that smell is just so fragrant. It's so Braj, you know. For me, it's like when I smell good cow dung burning, it's like, yeah, it just reminds you of Vrindavan. So, I mean, yeah, that's just it. That's country life. That's what it means to live simply and live with the cows. So, anyway, Krishna convinced all the residents to do this big anakut ceremony, to bring all these items and offer it to the hill, offer it to Govardhan, and everybody was bringing so much. I mean, this is nothing what you see here. They had like the whole side of the hill, the Eniyor side, which we'll discuss a little bit more later, the Eniyor side. Can we move this? Because I feel like when I look here, I'm looking, I don't need the bottom. Let's move this. So, yeah, they filled up the whole side of the hill, and then they started doing the offering to Giriraj. And then, of course, as the pastime goes, then Krishna himself manifested as Giriraj, and he started eating the preps himself. And he was eating, and they were cooking more, and then they were saying to the ladies, cook more, cook more. They were cooking more and bringing more, and they kept putting it in, and he kept saying, what did he keep saying? Aniyor, Aniyor. What does Aniyor mean? More, more, give me more, give me more. Aniyor, Aniyor. So as he kept saying, give me more, they kept bringing more, and he kept eating all of it. So, you know, Krishna can out-eat anybody. Once we had a gulab jamun eating contest. Anyone's ever had those contests? Yes? Okay, yeah. So how many gulabs can you eat in, like, how long did we do it? Like 1 minute, 2 minutes or something? So it was like, you know. But Krishna, he can out-eat everybody. He was eating everyone, eating everything. So in this way, Krishna was revealing himself, and the devotees were all engaged in this ecstatic pastime. But along the way, somebody became a little bit disturbed. And who was that? Indra. Yeah, Indra became upset, because basically all these offerings were really meant for him. Or he thought they were meant for him. And so he decided that this isn't right, this isn't correct. And this impudent little boy, this impudent child, 7-year-old boy, has convinced these imbeciles, these people of Vrindavan, that they shouldn't make the offering that they make to me every year. The Indra Yajna happens every year, and this year it didn't happen. And that is not correct. So, we must punish them, yes? We have to punish the residents. Actually, he ordered that everybody be killed. He wanted to kill everyone in Vrindavan. And so, he ordered and called who? The Samvantarka cloud, which is the cloud that comes at the time of devastation or annihilation. So he called the Samvantarka cloud, and he said, flood Vrindavan. Flood it until everyone basically dies. Till they drowned. And the rain started. And so all the devotees, they became bewildered. Oh no, what do we do? Oh no, Indra is mad. Now we're getting the reaction for not offering to Indra. But they all went to Krishna, as we see in the famous Krishna movies. Krishna, Krishna, help us, Krishna, Krishna. And then what did Krishna do? Krishna said, follow me. And he went to Govardhan Hill, and it's described. He had this little passageway. He went down in the passageway, and all of a sudden, and then Govardhan Hill just lifted up. Now, of course, 5,000 years ago, Govardhan Hill was much, much bigger than it is now. Who here has ever been to Govardhan? Much, 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 much bigger. But Krishna lifted it, and everybody came underneath and was basically safe underneath Govardhan Hill. And how long did they stay under the hill for?
7 days
and 7 nights, something like that. So they stayed under the hill for a long time. They were under the hill. Now, of course, in this is why it's considered such an intimate pastime, because nobody got to spend that much time with Krishna day in and day out. Even Mother Yashoda, she would have to say goodbye to Krishna in the mornings because he would go out to herd the cows, to take care of the cows. And every morning it was like this traumatic experience when Krishna would leave, and Mother Yashoda would be like, Krishna, Krishna, come back. You know, he'd start to leave, she'd call him back, she'd do something, and then he'd start, oh no, come back, Krishna, make sure, have you got this, have you got that, you have your packed lunch, you've got, and he's like, Mom, leave me alone, gotta go and herd the cows. He just wanted to go and play with the cowherd boys. And so finally he goes out into the fields, and they play and have so much fun. And the cowherd boys get to spend time with Krishna. And they're like, it's like tug of war with Krishna, you know? Because they're trying to get Krishna away from Mother Yashoda so they can go out and have fun, and then they get him. And then when they come back in the evening, you know, it's described, everybody's like having a big festival because Krishna's coming back from herding the cows. And they're like, Krishna, Krishna, hey, Krishna's back. And the cowherd boys are all sad because now Krishna's going to go home to be with his parents, and they're not going to get to see him. So everybody's always fighting and fighting for their time that they can get with Krishna. So for 7 days, everyone was able to be under the hill with Krishna and have full darshan of Krishna while he was standing there lifting Govardhan Hill. How is he lifting it? On the pinky of his left hand, which is generally considered, left hand is considered the weaker hand. Of course, if you're a lefty, then, you know, that may be a different story. But in general, lefty, and then the pinky. So the whole hill was just balancing on the tip of his finger. And so many different pastimes happen under the hill. I mean, I think you could probably do it. Some of you, your pinky looks pretty strong. You probably have some mystic cities as well. So anyway, it was very, very exalted. Meanwhile, they were all just absorbed in Krishna under the hill. But outside, you know, all this thunder and lightning. You're awake now, Kevin. All this thunder and lightning was pounding on Govardhan Hill. But because it was touching Krishna, he was like empowering Govardhan. The Govardhan Hill, it's described that not even like a rock got shifted. Not even one Sheila fell off. No Sheilas fell off Govardhan Hill, did they? So no one fell off, nothing, not even a blade of grass moved, even though it was the Samvantarka cloud that was... Bye. So even though the Samvantarka cloud was pounding on the hill, you know, everyone was protected, everyone was safe. Somehow the water didn't run underneath the hill, you know. All these different things we might materially think of. how it should have been. Yes.
Well, what about like all the animals that were on the hill?
Well, they were safe.
Well, but they weren't safe because they weren't under the hill, so they probably just all
died,
right?
No one died.
Well, you just said that they were all still... Nobody fell off the hill.
Well, I said the Sheilas. No, but many of the animals, you can see in the picture here, many of the animals, the cows and everyone, were underneath the hill.
So there were no cows on the hill at that time?
No, they all came under the hill.
Okay.
And any living entity that was on the hill, if not even one rock got moved off the hill, then nothing on the hill was damaged. No one on the hill, whether it was a bug or a rabbit or a squirrel or a mouse.
If the hill was very high, mm-hmm. maybe it went like above the clouds, you know, and then they could all go to the top of the hill and then they wouldn't get around.
Maybe your material calculations have nothing to do with describing Krishna's nectar. I don't know. Maybe that's it. Maybe that's how it happened. I just accept that it's a chincha. It's inconceivable how no one died. I mean, it isn't described that there were rivers of blood and mucus and bile where all the animals from the hill were being drowned alive and washing by the cowherds as they were safely protected, but they didn't care a fig about any other living entity as long as they were... It just isn't described like that. Did you read that anywhere?
No, not really.
Anyway, for a moment, let's just live inside of the fact that nobody died, that Indra was unsuccessful. He didn't kill even one.
There is a description that he sent his chakra,
his chakra acted as like an umbrella. Yeah, I don't remember that one, but it's possible. Anything could have happened. Ask Krishna, did you send your chakra? Okay. I think it just wants me to get on with the pastor. So we're not going to get hung up on this, but there are lots of questions that can be asked, and I've heard many of them asked over the years. And generally, the final conclusion is, all's well that ends well. Everybody survived. The only person who got hurt in the whole thing, there was one person who really got hurt, and that was Lord Indra. So Lord Indra got hurt. What got hurt? His zero, what? His ego, yes.
Huh?
His butt hurt.
No, it's an expression, right?
That his butt hurt?
No, when your butt hurt, you're like, your false ego. It's
like... Am I misunderstanding? I think you've been hanging out with Kavi Prabhu too.
He's saying battered.
Oh, he got battered.
What?
Either you said his butt hurt, or he got buttered, like buttered, like you butter toast, or he got battered, like pakora.
The first one, I thought is an expression for being a false ego being, or being like a little bit whining.
I never heard that one.
You know the expression?
No.
Okay.
You know the expression?
It's an American thing, no?
Well, being American, his butt hurt.
He was butt hurt.
Oh, yeah, I know.
He was what?
He was butt hurt.
Okay, I think it's okay that we accept that this is a possible terminology, but it's not one I read in Bhagavatam or Krishna book. So it's coming straight out of the USA. It's probably a very modern colloquialism, probably coming straight out of the ghettos. And I don't know. I don't think it's anything that the upper class would say. But anyway, I'll go with his ego got smashed. Yes, definitely. His false pride was battered. Buttered. Okay, so anyway, Indra, he realized after unleashing everything that he could unleash on the residents of Govardhan and the residents of Vrindavan and Braj, that something wasn't normal here, that his power and potency was not having the effect that it should. And then he realized, oh, maybe I've made a big mistake. Maybe I've done something incorrect here. And so Indra then stopped all the torrents of rain and unleashing. And he basically went to meet with Krishna. And at that point he began to offer very sincere prayers. Excuse me, these prayers can be found in chapter 27. Very nice prayers, prayers of humility and accepting that Krishna is the Supreme Lord, and actually what I've done is really incorrect, and I'm begging forgiveness for this. And we discussed once before how this must be for a man who's like, you know, if you look at him, he's in his 40s, 50s, you know, to be begging forgiveness from a 7-year-old is just not a done thing, even in material life, you know. It's like, but what to speak of, you know, in this situation. So, and Indra, he's just like, he's the king of heaven, and he's begging forgiveness from Krishna. So there are some primary themes of this pastime. The main one is, or one of them is, the whole that there's no need for demigod worship. I mean, it is part of Vedic culture, but Krishna consciousness goes beyond that because we go straight to the root. So there you don't need to worship the demigods because the demigods are only getting their potency from Krishna ultimately. So they can't give anything that Krishna doesn't sanction and like that. So another one is this, because Krishna, he achieves many things with one action or one activity. So he also curbed Indra's false pride. And Indra's a devotee also, no doubt he's a devotee. All the demigods are devotees, and to have such a high position as to be the king of heaven means that he must be quite an exalted devotee in one sense. At the same time, he has a lot of responsibility, but false pride can arise even in devotees. In case no one's noticed, and myself, yes, and ourselves, we may notice. So sometimes he gives us hints, Krishna, from within, that we're getting a little puffed up. Sometimes he has to scream. And for Indra, he unleashed everything, thinking he was so powerful, the Lord of Thunder, the God of Thunder. He was unleashing, and nothing was happening, so his false pride was curbed. The idea of service, because Krishna engaged everyone in service to Govardhan Hill, but also to him. Also, instead of offering worship to Indra, they offered worship to Krishna. So he taught everyone that actually worship is meant for me. And you can do that also through my representative, who is?
Giri Govardhan.
And then the Anayor principle, that no matter how much we give, Krishna is always going to ask for more. So on those days when you think you've had enough, and you think, Krishna, my God, how much do you want from me? Right? Anyone's ever felt like that? What are you asking for more? God is like, oh yeah, what do you want? And what's he going to say to you? Anayor, give me more. Or often people are like, they offer something with this hand, but behind their back they're keeping
a stash.
A little bit for later, you know, a little bit for Ron, right? You know what I'm saying? A little bit for Ron, later on. Keeping a little bit for me, for later. Here's one for Krishna and two for me. Two for Krishna, three for me. But Krishna, he's like, thank you, but he's looking over the shoulder like, what do you got back there? What are you holding back? So he's always asking for more. Also the shelter principle, that Krishna is the ultimate shelter. It's interesting because, you know, when you read this pastime, you think, well, Krishna is really the reason that they almost all got killed. He almost killed the whole village, didn't he? It's actually Krishna's fault. Anyone agrees? Yeah, it's Krishna's fault. You might,
oh my God.
Watch it out. Well, I mean, he's the one that told him not to worship Indra, right? So it's his fault. They could have all blamed Krishna. They could have said, you silly little boy. Why do we listen to this silly little boy? Yes? But they didn't. When the going got tough, where did they all go? They went to Krishna. And what did he do? He still protected them. Because even sometimes in our quest for doing the right thing, we're still going to meet with opposition. We're still going to meet with opposition. But just because it's doing the right thing, because Krishna says it's the right thing, doesn't mean there won't still be opposition from the material energy. So it means we shouldn't try to take shelter, then, oh no, now the material energy is unleashing, let me take shelter of the material energy. I must have done something wrong. We still have to take shelter of Krishna, and he will give that shelter. And Krishna also, which is the main reason why he comes, right? Paritranaya sadunam vinashaya chuduskutam dharma samstarpanathya sambhavami yuge yuge. Millennium after millennium he comes, but the main reason is paritranaya sadunam, to deliver the sadhus, to deliver the devotees. So he likes to spend time with his devotees. And he got to spend, he reciprocated with everyone by spending 7 solid days and nights with everyone under the hill. So in that way, Krishna is reciprocating. And also the principle of humility and rectification, that ultimately we have to cultivate and develop humility. And and sometimes we have to do whatever we have to do to rectify ourselves, as in the case of Indra, what to speak of us. So, I have, that was 9 slides out of 47. Anyone want to do the math on that? Shishmita's like, So that means there's still 38 slides left. And the idea was actually, if there was time, which there isn't, to do Govardhan Parikram. Yeah. So everyone wants to do Govardhan Parikram? Should I make it a really quick Parikram? But what?
Lightning speed.
Right. Yeah. So one thing we need when you do Govardhan, when you do Parikram, is you need to have kirtan. Because the holy Dhamma only opens up through the holy name. So you have to have chanting if you're going to do Parikram. So this Parikram will be quick, and you can do a quick Parikram and you can do short Parikram. When I used to stay in Govardhan at the Govardhan Palace, the ISKCON Bhaktivedanta Ashram, especially during Kartik when Vaisheshi Kapu was there, you go from Mangalarti, have darshan, midway through Mangalarti, you're out the door. Now Vaisheshi Kapu is a man of large stature with long legs. Confirmed. And we would be able to do the whole Govardhan Parikram while chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, and be back in time for breakfast prasad. Haribo! So that would mean it would take usually around 3 to 3.5 hours. So, but Govardhan Hill takes the shape of a peacock, in case you didn't know, so it's like a peacock in shape, the whole thing. Peacock with its head tucked under. Radhakund and Shyamakund are the eyes, and the other end is the tail, like that. Anyway, there's lots of things to describe, but we'll have to go pretty quick. This is one of the nicest sections of Govardhan. This is going over, around the tail section where the sand is all smashed and really soft. Most of the rest of Govardhan Parikram path is not like that. And this part is really nice on the feet, except when you start early in the morning, and if it's cold, then your feet become numb by walking in this like sand-like thing. So, we're going to have kirtan. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, everybody, Hare Hare, bala bala bala, Hare Abba, Hare Abba, so the Parikram path is how long? How many miles? We do it in miles because I'm American.
7 miles. 7.
Almost.
8.
Okay, it wasn't almost. I apologize. But that was very good. Huh? So you went the other way. You guys are learning. Double seven, yeah. 13, he said. Okay, you're from Germany? Okay. 77. Whew, okay, anyway. 14. So 14 miles. But there's another path. The path that Sanatan Goswami used to take when he used to do daily parikram is 24 miles. So 10 extra miles, because there's a point where you can cut in and go near to Govardhan and go around at the far end, at the tail end. But he used to stay on the outside of the path, and that adds an extra 10 miles, so 14 miles. And these are some of the things that you'll see, just so beautiful, the aromas, and yeah, it's just so uplifting. So, anyone wants to hear a little bit about the history of Giriraj?
Yeah.
So where did Giriraj come from? Well, there's a whole thing, and I didn't bring it down. Oh no, and I don't have it in my notes. Okay, so we'll have to be quick anyway. So basically, Giriraj, when Krishna said that he was coming to this earthly planet, and he said to Radharani, I want you to come also. Radharani said, no way, Jose, I'm not going to Earth unless I'll go on a few conditions. And what were those conditions? The Giriraj, well, that was very good. Yes, Giriraj has to be there. And who else has to be there? Kamsa. No. No. The Jamuna. So Giriraj, the Jamuna, and? One other thing that is going out of my mind, I can't remember now what it is.
Tulsi.
I don't think so, but yeah, we'll say Tulsi for now. But anyway, the main thing is that she was only going to come if Giriraj is coming. And Krishna says, don't worry, I'm not just taking the Jamuna and Govardhan, I'm taking the entire Goloka Vrindavan, and we're going, I've packed the bag, the whole thing is there. The entire Goloka is in the bag, babe, and we're going. So let's go. And then they just went and they set up shop and the whole of Vrindavan manifested. So Vrindavan, because Vrindavan is not different from Goloka Vrindavan. So Krishna is described, I remember hearing one of the first lectures by Kadambakanda Maharaj, he described, when Krishna goes on vacation, he doesn't just take a couple of bags. He takes his entire town, his whole village with him. They all go and they all came to Vrindavan. So of course Govardhan was there. But for Govardhan to manifest in the material world, he had to appear. And he appeared to the son of Dronachal, and I can't remember the mother's name now. but anyway, he appeared as a mountain. So Giriraj appeared as a mountain in the material world. And in a place where it's... Because actually it used to be that mountains had wings. Okay, we're not going to get into that. A few of you went, like, that happened. But Indra clipped them all off, so they had to stay put. But anyway, that's a whole other story. So he was born to in the family of mountains. But when he was born, everybody knew that he was going to be the king of mountains. So therefore he got the name Giriraj. So Giri means mountain and Raj means king. So Giriraj. So he became Giriraj. And where he appeared, he stayed for a long time. And then this Muni, what's his name? Nope. Anyway, see, this is what happens. I didn't put it in my notes and I didn't bring the paper down. So anyway, this Muni, might be Agastya Muni, but anyway, this Muni, he came and he saw Giriraj and he thought, oh, he's a very nice mountain. Look how many wonderful things grow on him. And so he approached his parents and he said, I'd like to take him with me to... You're not far off. Where is the place of Lord Shiva along the Ganga? Huh? Not Kailash. Where everyone worships Lord Shiva. Varanasi. So he said, I'm going to take him to Varanasi because it's just a flat area and we need some mountains there. So somehow he had some mystic city, some mystic potency. So he was granted the right to carry Giriraj on one condition. That if he ever sat Giriraj down, wherever he sat him down, Giriraj would stay put. So they were traveling, and he was carrying Giriraj. Amazingly enough, somehow he was carrying Giriraj. And then all of a sudden, Giriraj realized that we're going to go by Braj, and that's where I'm going to stay. And so he made this Muni have to attend to the call of nature. Yes, attend to the call of nature. Going to the toilet, I mean, they didn't have toilets. You just went into the woods. So all of a sudden this Muni's like, ooh, And he thought, oh, I think I'm going to have to take a little break. So he stopped and he sat down, Giri Raj. Then he went and attended to his business. And then he came back and he said, okay, let's go. And Giri Raj said, you put me down. And this is where I'm going to stay. So then he wound up staying there. And so that's how Giri Raj got placed there. But the Muni became so upset that he cursed Giri Raj. Not a very nice thing to do, is it? So he cursed him. And what was the curse? So her was... how did he curse him? Yeah, to shrink the size of a sesame seed or a mustard seed every day. So actually, Giri Raj used to be so high, but he's actually getting smaller and smaller. And it's described that when Giri Raj and the Jamuna, when they are finally gone, when they disappear, then that is when Kali Yuga will unleash in full force. So slowly, slowly, Giri Raj is shrinking. And of course, there's this famous verse. I'm not going to go through that now. But we're going to start our parikram. Okay, and it's 9 o'clock, and we've got 34 slides. Okay, so, okay. Where do you start the parikram? Huh? I love you, Sonny. You're great. Yeah, you started at the beginning. Where? Some people start at Kusum Sarovara, yes. But very close to Kusum Sarovara is another place where actually Lord Chaitanya started, Lord Nityananda, Sanat Goswami, and most of the acharyas say you should start at Manasi Ganga. You should start at Manasi Ganga. And you should start by taking bath in Manasi Ganga. So this is Manasi Ganga. Manasa means from the mind, and Ganga means, of course, Ganga Devi, because after killing Vatsasura, the calf demon, all the gopis were teasing Krishna and told him he should go and take bath because he killed the cow. So the family was going to go all the way to the Ganga. And then Krishna said, we don't have to go all the way to the Ganga. Ganga Devi is here. And he called Ganga Devi there. And then she manifested this beautiful lake. So many pastimes occur on this lake. Also the boat pastimes of Radha and Krishna. So the gopis want to cross over the lake to get to the other side. And Krishna is the boatman. And it's a whole boat leela, which I would tell if we had time, but we don't have time. But so like that, so many pastimes happen here. And then after taking bath in the Manasi Ganga, then you have to go for darshan of Haridev. So Haridev deity is the presiding deity of the western petal of Braj Dham. And he's the lifter of Govardhan Hill. And his manifestation was that when the gopis once were in this area next to Manasi Ganga, and they were calling out for Krishna, and they started calling, Haridev, Haridev, Haridev. And then Krishna appeared as Giridhari, just like here on this little pendant that Srimati Radharani is holding. So after you have darshan of Haridev, which you've all had now, by the way, so you've all, everyone, imagine yourselves having a dip in Manasi Ganga, you know, like this. Do the whole thing. I used to go. And or you can just take three drops. I had some water, I could throw it on you like that. Manasi Ganga. You had darshan of Haridev, offer pranams. Pray to Haridev that we can safely circumambulate Giri Raj and become pure servants of our spiritual master, Srila Prabhupada, with the mood of Chanada Pisudichena. Yes. Okay, so then you leave and you go into Govardhan town, and there's this big, big temple there. Those of you who have been, you're kind of like, oh yeah, you're feeling it right about now. So you go into Govardhan town. This area is called Dangati. So this is the low point of Govardhan Hill where the gopis used to cross over, but Krishna would go there and perform his tax collector pastimes. So the gopis would come with their big churns on their heads of the yogurt and milk and so many things, and Krishna would dress up in disguise and he would say, no, you cannot pass here until you pay the tax. So this is the Dangati. So like that, he would perform these pastimes. And so you go on this, and then you hang a left, and you go on the Parikram Marg, and you pass about 10 million beggars, all looking. So if you're good, you get a bag full of like pices, not even pices. What are they? They're like less than a paisa, you know. And then you can just try to give everybody something. But there's these beggars, they go there every year, especially during Kartik. And then on the left-hand side, you'll pass the Govardhan Palace, which is the ISKCON Bhaktivedanta Ashram area. This is where Keshav Bharati Maharaj stays for many, many, many years, and is his home, really. And so like this, and if you carry on, then you'll pass Aniyur, is on the right-hand side, which is where everyone offered all the preparations and where the devotees do their pujas. And when I used to be there for Govardhan Puja, we used to also cook lots of stuff and take it right up onto the hill and offer it right on Govardhan Hill. And you carry on past Aniyur, and you come to a wonderful place called, what is it? Govinda Kund. Yes, so this is Govinda Kund. This is a kund that was created when they bathed Krishna after the Govardhan Leela, and Lord Indra came, and he brought Surabhi, and he brought Aravita, is his elephant. And after he apologized, then they took some milk and they started to have abhishek of him, and then this beautiful kund was created. So Govinda Kund is also the area where Madhavendra Puri found the Gopal deity. So the Gopal deity, and then he installed the Gopal deity. The deity is now known as Srinachi. Very good, Sunny. Yes, Srinachi, and is located in Nathdwar. Yeah, Nathdwar, which is in Rajasthan. So when the whole thing happened with the Mughal Empire, they were smashing all the deities. So many of the deities were moved to Rajasthan because the Rajasthani kings, they were hard guys. Nobody messed with them. They were like, they'll just take you out, no problem. So many of the deities from Vrindavan moved to Rajasthan. So then you go around the, go around this end. So we started back here, and now we're over here, going around. This is the tail end, and this area is called Pancholi, and this is also, there's an area, a place here, the Rasa Stali, one of the places where Krishna would perform Ras Leela. And there's another place called the Apsara Kund, where many Apsaras came and offered and worshipped Krishna. So this is the Lota Baba temple. So many people know it's a famous temple there, Lota Baba. So you can go in and have darshan of Lota Baba. And Lota Baba is Krishna's friend, that when Krishna left Vrindavan, when Akura came and took him, Krishna's friend came up and said, "Krishna, where are you going?" And he said, "I have to go to Mathura." And he said, "When are you coming back?" And Krishna said, "I'm coming back the day after tomorrow, and I'll see you there." And Lota Baba went to this area, to Pancholi, and he sat down, and it's described he hasn't left since. He's still waiting for Krishna to come back. So it's a nice mood when you go there to enter into that mood of waiting for Krishna and having that strong desire. So like that. So then we go around the other side, and you see Aravata Kund and Surabhi Kund. So this is when Lord Indra first came. This is where Surabhi was, and with her milk she created a kund, and Aravata brought Ganga there, and he filled up this kund with Ganga water also. So this is Surabhi Kund is also there. So like that, the beautiful, beautiful kund. So we're not doing so much kirtan. Let's do kirtan now, and I'll take bath in Surabhi Kund. Okay, ready? Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Hare.
One more time.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Just so good. big parikram, there's lots of devotees, you can't make it to the kun yourself, so someone goes down and fills up a bucket and they come out and just slash it all over everyone. So then we go to Jatipur. So Jatipur is named after who?
Jati.
Yes. No. Jatipur is named after Madhavendra Puri. Because Madhavendra Puri is sannyasi, and Jati is like a colloquial term for yati, which means sannyasi. So it was named for him. This is where he used to stay when he would go and worship the beautiful Gopal deity, which later became Nathji, Sri Nathji. So this is Gopal approaching Madhavendra Puri and saying, "My dear sir, I just want a little milk." Right? Or maybe he brought him milk, rather. So like that. So this is Jatipur. And it's kind of, after you go around Panchal, it's like the first kind of town that you come into. It's like, oh my God, now there's like people and all kinds of stuff going on here. What's happening? And so, you know, you get like this kind of thing. You can see down here at the bottom, you can't see. Some nectar garbage hiding the Dham, the real Dham. So, anyway, there are different pastimes here, but we're going to skip them. And we'll have some kirtan. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama. Okay, so now we've reached Uddhav Kund. Hari Bol. So we've just been hearing about the conversation between Krishna and Uddhav. So this is Uddhav Kund. This is where Uddhav went when he had to deliver the message to the gopis, and he had the conversation with them. And this is the place where he took that vow or made the statement that he once, because he was so overwhelmed by the devotion that the gopis had for Krishna, that he said, "I just want to take birth as a..." No, not as a gopi. A blade of grass, a creeper. A creeper in Braj. If I could just take birth as a little weed, I would be so happy, because then when the devotees of Krishna walk along, they'll kick dust on me. And that'll be the perfection of my life. So this is the mood of Uddhav. And this is Uddhav Kund. So we'll get some water and have kirtan. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Hare Hare. Okay, so we just skipped a lot. So now we're at a place called Malyahari Kund. I always called it Malharya Kund, but it's Malyahari Kund. And this is a very special place. They're all special, but it's just a small area. And this is where the gopis is described that after they would pick flowers at Kusum Sarovar, they would go here and they would make the garlands. So like that. So the next time you're making garlands, ladies, you can imagine yourself being at Malyahari Kund, just like with the gopis, making garlands for Krishna. But it's more well known, it's a very secret place also, but it's more well known for the Mukta Charit pastime, which is the pearl pastime. Anyone knows the pearl pastime? So in short, basically, the gopis, they got some pearls from their mothers, and they were stringing pearl necklaces, and Krishna came along and said, "Oh wow, they're really beautiful, can I have one?" And they said? They said, "No way, Jose, get out of Dodge, Krishna. We're not doing anything for you. Hit the road, Jack." And Krishna said, "Come on, girls." And he said, "No, we don't want anything to do with you. Go away. You're a boy. Quit being naughty." And so he went away. And what did he do? He went to Mother Yashoda. And he said, "Mother Yashoda, can I please have some pearls?" And she said, "What do you want pearls for?" And he said, "Well, the gopis, they're making pearl necklaces, and I want to make necklaces for the cows, for the cows." And she said, "Well, I've only got a few pearls." And he said, "It's okay, I'm going to plant them and water them and grow pearls." And she said, "Krishna, you can't grow pearls like that. Pearls come out of the ocean. They come out of oysters. You can't grow pearls." And he said, "Come on, Ma, give me some pearls." So she gave him some pearls, because that's what She does, for Krishna. So she gave him some pearls, and Krishna went out and planted pearls, and he started watering them with milk from the cows and with ghee. And then and he told the ladies, he went back to the gopis and said, I'm growing my own pearls. Soon I'm going to have many, many more pearls than you've ever had. And they said, how did you get so many pearls? He said, I'm growing them. And they said, ha, 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 Krishna, you can't grow pearls. And then he said, you watch. And then he went back. They said, all that's going to grow is thorn bushes. And so he went back and he was watering again. And then sprouts started to come. And after a few days, there were bushes that were bearing these huge pearls. Pearls growing on bushes. Ladies, you're supposed to go, ooh, your eyes are supposed to open like, wow, pearls. Or guys can do it, we can always sell them. So pearls growing on bushes. And then Krishna started picking these pearls and making necklaces and decorating the cows, and the ladies all became very envious. Yeah, even in the spiritual world, there is envy. So they said, huh, we're going to do the same thing. So they took all the pearls that they had, they stuck them in the earth, and they started watering them with milk, and Krishna... It's not going to work. And guess what grew for them? Thorn bushes. Ha, 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 ha. They got what they deserved. So, because they didn't give to Krishna, so then the ladies became upset. But in the end, Krishna said, they went and begged for pearls, and Krishna said, no. But eventually, Krishna said, okay. So he made these beautiful pearl necklaces, put them in gold boxes, and had them delivered to all the gopis. Hari Bol, Kirtan. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Hare, Bolo, 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 Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama, Hare Hare. So now we come to Radha-Kund. Oh, where are we? Down here? Yeah, Radha-Kund and Shyam-Kund. So here they are from aerial view. So beautiful Radha-Kund and Shyam-Kund. I think this must be in like monsoon season. And so they're the two eyes of the peacock of Govardhan Hill. And of course this is Radha-Kund, the most powerful, potent, auspicious place on the planet, the holiest of all holy places. So Radha-Kund, anyone's ever taken bath in Radha-Kund? Yes, okay. Yes, very special. So, if you've been to the VIP room, I have some Radha-Kund water. So everyone can take a bath. Anyway, lots of pastimes here, but we're really running out of time, so we'll keep going. So from Radha-Kund, you go on to what I consider one of the most beautiful places, which is Kusum Sarovar. So this very, very beautiful, beautiful lake. And when we would stay in Govardhan, we would go there and swim every day in Kusum Sarovar. So beautiful. And this is where many, many pastimes, also many water pastimes happen here. And this is where the gopis used to go and pick flowers for making the garlands. It's very beautiful. That's also where Lord Chaitanya, before he started his parikrama, after he left Radha-Kund and he passed by Kusum Sarovar, he went into ecstasy and he just started jumping around and he ran and grabbed hold of this Giriraj, this rock, and tears of ecstasy were pouring out on it. It's also supposedly the place where the hair combing pastime, hair brushing pastime happened. What is the name? Do you remember the name? I was trying to remember. I want to say Ban Bihari. Is it Ban? Is that right? Ban Bihari. So Krishna brushes Srimati Radharani's hair like that. And so you're at Kusum Sarovar and meditating on all these pastimes and having bath. And then you come back into Govardhan town because you're naturally going back to the ISKCON center. And you have to make a stop by the Giriraj sweet shop. I mean, you can't leave Govardhan without some sweets. And especially... Son Popery, yes, oh my goodness. And if you don't know what it is, you don't know what it is, you know. You think Rasagula is good? Oh, Son Popery is from Govardhan, my God. First time I was there, I was with my godbrother Nitai Prabhu, and he was like, oh, we got to get some Son Popery. And so we were like, okay, we got like a box. I think they come in like half kg or 1 kg boxes. And we got one, and then we walked off and just started eating it. We were like, whoa! And we went back and we got 8 boxes. And we had them. It was kind of against the yatra rules. And we were like, woohoo! And then we got on the bus and we were like, we were so high from eating this. So probably this is basically sugar and ghee. We were just like, wow! And it was so nectar. And then we just, I think we ate like 4 boxes of it. That the next day we weren't on the yatra. We were like, but yeah, you have to have sompapri. And then you're back at Manasi Ganga and you can have bath again and then go back. Hare Krishna. Govardhan Parikram Ki.
Jai.
Okay, that's it. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Giriraj Maharaj Ki Jai. Any questions? Okay, good. So now we're going to have
kirtan.
Krishna Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna Hare Hare. Okay, go, man. Yes, that's the ecstasy you should feel at the end of Govardhan Parikram.
We're not going to watch the movie.
We're going to have Abhishek. Kiriraj Abhishek Ki. Hare Krishna. So if everyone can do whatever they need to do to get ready for the Abhishek, which is at 9:30. Hari Bol.
Jai.
Jai.